4/3, chock full of features. But 2 years down the line, is it a worthy £1,200-1,300 spend? Let's check it out.
It's only 574 grams. It's weatherproof. You've got a decent 20 megapixel live mast sensor. Probably, arguably, one of the better in-body image stabilization systems on the market. Olympus, you know, good reputation for that. So you got that 5-axis IBIS right there. 15 frames per second mechanical, 60 frames per second electronic, 1/8000th high-speed mechanical shutter, cinema 4K at 24 frames per second at a decent high frame rate. You've got this nice articulating screen, which is easy to flip open right there. They've definitely thought about the grip, which you would hope. These small mirrorless cameras, especially the SLR ones, you know, sometimes they can lack a decent all-day grip. Now, compared to the previous model, they've moved this lug up here so it's completely out of the way, so it's not messing up your operating and handling. This grip now is taller. It's a very nice bit of kit, well packed. They've even included on this side your spot, a headphone socket, as well as the mic and the HDMI and USB-C. Remember, this is 2 years old now, and your people like Olympus and Panasonic do like to pack the tech in, even though, you know, it's Micro Four Thirds or Four Thirds system. Twin card slots right there, and everything just feels decent. Even the battery door has a nice sure lock on it. Things are where they should be. Yes, we said there's a lot of buttons, a lot of customization possible, so it could take you, you know, a little bit of a head scratch to get through the menu, but as you'll see, completely touch screen. When you use that EVF, which is, you know, pretty nice, it's not very soulful. I don't know if organic's the word. It's definitely a techie bit of kit, but it's clear enough and it works, and you can still operate, for example, the autofocus on a decent amount of the touchscreen while you're looking through the EVF. The EVF, as we're talking about, it sticks out enough so that you're not rubbing your conk on the screen every time you try to use it. You do have access to a lot of the information that you need there and to change them, but as I say, it might be a bit of a learning curve for you to get around how to change certain things. You'll get there. It's not that difficult, but it might not be as intuitive menu-wise as you might be used to on some other brands, not all. Seems to be the techie sort of cameras don't have the best menus, bizarrely. Maybe they just try to pack things out. In fact, when this first came out, people said maybe it's overpacked. We've got 121-point dual fast autofocus, a whole bunch of other specs. 50 megapixel mode might be interesting for the landscape shooters. Focus bracketing, built-in Wi-Fi. Yeah, really is feature-packed. And I think you can see a relatively well-designed little number. So what we're going to do, we're going to throw on this 12-40 2.8 Pro, and we're going to show off, probably not the best word, some of the random samples that I've got. Now, I'm afraid the weather was just completely against me, and I was a little bit too busy to get certain shots that I really wanted, but we've got enough to just show a small amount of what this can do. But really, it's all about the comments below. There will be a video showing this lens a little bit closer, so look out for that too. But really, we're going to get back, summarize my thoughts, and then check out your comments below. We'll be right back.
Yes, the sensor is smaller than what were sort of, you could say, competitors price-wise originally. But I think this is a solid feature-packed and very worthy pro camera. The battery life, especially for a mirrorless camera, was really good. After a day of random shooting stills, video chimping while reviewing on the screen, so I think over 500 stills plus a whole load of video clips, I was still on 53% battery. To me, that is superb for a camera of this size and nature. Looks like Olympus are paying attention to what we need battery wise. I mean, you're going to carry spares anyway, but that is a definite pro for a pro camera. Obviously, most important, the image quality is excellent. I mean, when you're pushing past 6400, it's not probably going to be maybe the camera for you. The EVF is very clear to use. It felt a little bit too techy to me. I don't know, it just felt a little bit unnatural at times, but to be fair, it was clear. Everything was there that I needed to see. It just wasn't, it's a bit hipster, but, and I'm not hipster, but a bit lacking organic feel, do you know what I mean? But that's by the by. I don't think that's what this body is supposed to be. You know, coming from the Fuji systems, things just feel soulful. This feels more techie, and that might be your thing. That's completely cool. Yeah, it is jam-packed with technology. The menu system can be a little bit awkward to get used to. I'm not a big fan of that, and it was a bit more of a learning curve, but I don't think that's a problem. Again, if you're a techie, I don't think you'll mind. You'll get used to it. There's a lot of nice customizations that you can do with this body. Overall, I've really got to say, it's a comfortable camera to use across a long day. The build quality is nice. That grip is nice and deep and not obstructed by anything, you know, that sometimes the lugs and the straps and things like that, buttons and whatnot. I think it works a treat, and the weatherproof nature, I mean, yeah, I got stuck out in the rain a little bit trying to get some low light shots, and it's still absolutely fine. It kept chugging along, and I think the images were okay as well, even though it was all handheld, very slow, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, hopefully I'll be able to have shown you some of that. That Olympus IBIS works a treat, kept things nice and stable, and in video mode, almost flawless. I don't know if that's fair to say, but yeah, the video mode, extremely useful. The camera focuses fast and sure, and the option to shoot sports and action up to 60 frames per second is very welcome. There's clearly a lot more that we could go into, but for now, if you're a four-thirds shooter and you need something that could step up a little bit, especially if you're a sports action or even landscape with that high megapixel mode, I think this is definitely a camera that you want to get your hands on and check out. It's a serious shooter, even a couple years down the line, and now that the price to me seems pretty sensible, $1,200-$1,300, and even less if you know where to look, I think this is one still not to be ignored. Don't forget to let us know what you think, if you've used it or any of the other Olympuses around this sort of range. Let us know, or if there's something you think it's lacking, let us know. But especially, really, if your view's a thing, you know, let's not be paper pixel peepers or pixel peepers full stop. We're going to be doing a video on the lens that I used with this, the 12-14, another quick rip around that lens so we can get a little bit of a conversation going, especially about how these Olympuses fare in the pro world. Personally, I haven't used them in the pro world, but I don't see too many reasons why I couldn't do a number with a pair of these bodies or something, you know, similar. But don't worry, I'm not moving from Fujifilm, at least for a good while. There we go then, another winner Micro Four Thirds, this time from Olympus. I look forward to your comments below. Make sure to subscribe and stay tuned. I think that's the whole point of staying subscribed.